Welcome back to the Introduction to Python and Programming course. This is Chapter 7, Part 2. So in the first part of Chapter 7, we looked at all kinds of sequences. What are sequences? Well, in Python, a sequence is any data type that fulfills four properties. And the properties are that we must be able to iterate or loop over the object. We also have to do that in order. So in other words, the data type must be reversible. And in other words, that means we have a forward order as well. A sequence is finite. And lastly, any sequence is also, abstractly speaking, a container, so it contains references to other objects. What was the big, or one big downside in the first part of Chapter 7? Well, for example, we looked at the list type, and the list type was characterized by holding references to all the objects that it holds, and all of the objects exist in memory simultaneously. Now you may wonder, how can we model a sequence without expressing or without storing all the elements of the sequence in memory explicitly? Well, we have seen one example already. The range built-in allows us to go over a range of integer numbers in one by one. And we have seen that in this situation, we only get the integer objects one at a time. And we don't have them in memory simultaneously, which is a big improvement memory-wise. And we have seen when we worked with numbers, so for example, when in Chapter 2 we defined a function called average evens, the function was given a parameter called numbers. And then this was a list of any numbers. It could also be floats. And then what the function did is, internally, it went over all the numbers and rounded them to get integer objects, and then it went over the integer objects and filtered them to only keep the even numbers, and then finally we took the average. And we saw when you go back to the recording of Chapter 2, you will see that in Python Tutor we visualized one of these functions, and when we called the function we had not only the original numbers list in memory, but we had also up to three copies of the original list. And that was very bad, so that means when we did the calculation back then, we used a lot of memory. And yeah, the question is, can we do better? And the answer is, of course, yes, we can. And we will do so by introducing now formally the so-called map filter reduce paradigm. We have already seen the map filter reduce paradigm briefly in the end of Chapter 4. And also in this chapter, in the second part of Chapter 7, we will look at data types that allow us to model data that doesn't exist in memory. Okay, so let's look at an example. Let's look at the first of the three steps, the mapping step. And we do so with our familiar example. We just take the list of numbers from 1 to 12 unordered. And now we look at the first of the three steps, mapping. So what is mapping? Well, a map is regarded as a transformation that takes the elements of a sequence, the x's, so to say, one by one, and transforms them into y's by some mathematical functions. So let's see one example. So here we have a function called transform. It takes one element, and what it does is it just returns the square of the element plus one. We have seen exactly this transformation already before in Chapter 4. So let's define this function. And now the question is, how can I apply this transform function to all the elements in the numbers list? So let's see a naive way of doing that. That uses one of the list methods we saw in the first part of Chapter 7, the append method. So what we do here in this code cell is we create a new list, transformed numbers, which is empty in the beginning. And then we loop over the numbers list. And within the loop, we call every element in the old numbers list just old. And then we call the transform function, pass it the old, store the result as new. And then we go ahead and we append the transformed element to the transformed numbers list. So if I run this code cell, after that, the list transformed numbers will contain all the individual numbers. So what that means is in memory, and here in the memory diagrams, I will try to be brief, so I won't draw everything. I will just draw you the big picture, so to say. So we started with a list, and we know a list is a so-called array, and this is of type list. And the list contains references and two int objects. And I will just draw them in a small way here. This is our original list called numbers. And now what we did is we created a new list that was empty in the beginning. And we call this list transformed numbers. And then as we went over the for loop, we took the individual element that all existed simultaneously in memory, and we transformed them, and we created new elements that we put into this new list here. And at the end of the day, this transformed list, transformed numbers list, I will zoom out a bit here, this transformed numbers list is contains just as many elements as the first numbers list. So now we have doubled our memory. Okay, that is mapping. And now the question is, can we do that in a nicer way? And the answer is, of course, yes. And how do we do that? We use Python's map built-in. So we will find it in the documentation of all the built-in functions. And if we look for m map here, and so let's see what does map do. It takes at least two arguments, possibly more. And the first argument is a reference to a function. So in other words, it's something callable. And then the second argument must be an iterable. It doesn't say it must be a list or something. It just says, in abstract terms, it must be an iterable object. And then it says, the documentation says, return an iterator that applies function to every item in iterable. So as of now, we don't know yet what is an iterator. I will introduce this word towards the end of this chapter. But iterator is also an abstract concept, just like iterable. So let's continue in the presentation. So as I said, map takes two arguments. The first one is a callable, so we just pass in the reference to the function. So by the way, as you may remember, the function transform is basically, here we have an object of type function, and we have the name transform, and this also exists in memory. So functions are also objects in memory, and yeah, so this also exists, and this is why we can pass it as an argument. So I'm passing the reference, which means here the reference to this function object. That's what I pass to the map built-in. And also, of course, a reference to the numbers list. And whatever I get back from that, the iterator, I store in a variable called transformer. Okay, so let's see what is transformer. And it just tells me it's a map. And what we see there is basically, the first word here means that's the type, so it's an object of type map. And this here, in the hexadecimal notation here, that's basically the location in memory where this map object is stored. So this is we remember that the angle brackets here, they by convention mean that I cannot copy paste this back into a code cell. This is not a literal. So in other words, I cannot, it's not a literal just like, for example, a numeric literal. I can create map objects only with the map built-in function. So now the question is, well, what is transformer? Transformer is a map. So basically what I got here in my memory diagram is I got a new object. I draw it down here. It also has something in it. And this is of type map. And now I have to write a bit nicer, of course. This is a transformer. So this is transform, the function, and this is transformer, the map object. So this is what we have done in memory. And now the question is, what can we do with this object? So let's, for example, we can use the next built-in function. So let's check in the documentation what the next built-in function does. So the next built-in function, as we can read, it takes as the first argument an iterator, so not an iterable, but an iterator. And then the documentation says, retrieve the next item in the iterator. Okay, so basically what that means is, if I now execute this code, sir, I get the first number that is transformed, the 50. So I'm asking to transform, and what transform does is it will give me back exactly one integer object. And then it is up to me as the programmer to decide what I will do with the 50. And in this situation, I didn't store it, so the 50 is just given back as output, and it is basically immediately forgotten. I did not store the 50. I didn't capture it, the return value. And now if I execute this last code cell again, I get back the next number, the 122. And if I go back in the slides, these are exactly the numbers 50, 122. These are exactly the same numbers that are in the transformed numbers list. However, I now just get them back on a one-by-one basis. So I'm basically getting back, I'm producing these objects here on a one-by-one basis. And now let's see what happens if I get to the end. So I execute the cell a couple of more times, and I see I go over all the numbers one by one. And then eventually, when I reach the end, I get something that is called a stop iteration error. And the stop iteration error indicates to us that now the map object, the transformer object, doesn't know how to give me the next integer. Why? Well, because it just ran out of integers. And now I can keep running this cell again and again, and I will always get a stop iteration. So the map object now, the transformer object from now on is useless. So all it does, it allows us to go over the numbers on a one-by-one basis once. And once we have done that, we basically have to create a new map object. Of course, we could do that. I can go back up and I run the cell again. I create a new transformer object. And now I can go over all the numbers again until I hit the stop iteration error again. Okay, so that's basically like a for loop. So in other words, what the map object gives me back, or the map function gives me back, it gives me back a map object. And what is a map object? A map object is basically like a for loop, just that it has not yet run. It's like a lazy for loop. It only runs one at a time when I make it run. And sometimes we say as programmers that I have to drive the object. I have to drive basically through the loop, so to say, manually, one by one. So what can I do with it? Well, I can use the map object, the map built in here, just as I used it on the slide before, and I can wrap it with the list constructor. And what this will do is, this will create a new map object that knows how to calculate the numbers one by one, and then the list constructor, basically does what I just did manually. It just goes over the map object and gets out the individual numbers and then stores it in a list. And now it and saves the list as transformed numbers. So basically what I just did is I regenerated this list here using a map object. This is what I did. I regenerated this. And whenever we go from an object that basically resembles a rule in memory that allows us to calculate individual items or objects, and we go from such a rule to an object that actually has all the objects in it that are to be calculated, then I call this to materialize. So in the first situation, I don't have all the simultaneous objects in memory, but then I materialize all the individual int objects, in this case, into a list. So materializing is the term that we want to use here. And what can I do with transformed numbers? Well, transformed numbers is, of course, just like a list, because we just created a new list. That's mapping. And now let's see the other two steps. So now filtering, the second step in the map filter reduce paradigm. And we will see that this step works basically just like the first step. So here I define a function. I call it isEven. And the function, again, takes one element. And then it checks if the element is even. We modulo divide by 2 and check if there is no rest. And if there is no rest, we know that the number is even. And in the case where the number is even, I return true. And in the other case, I return false. So this is also an example of the early exit pattern. Okay, so this function takes an element and returns a true or false. How can I apply this function to all the elements in a sequence? Well, let's do it first in our old naive way. Well, at first I take I create a new list called even numbers that is empty in the beginning, and then I loop over the transformed numbers. So this is the materialized and transformed numbers. And for every number, I pass the number to the isEven function. And again, this function gives me back a true or false. So this is why I put this function as the condition of an if statement into this line here. And in the case I get back a true, I have an even function, an even number. And in this case, I append the number to the even number list. Okay, so I run this code. And after that, I have an even numbers list that is now shorter. But it's still materialized. So what happens here effectively is now I still have here the list object. And this now has a couple of integers. But it's now shorter, right? So that's now even numbers. So let's write here maybe even numbers. And of course, there is a reference going here. So now, in our computer's memory, we have the original numbers list up here, we have the transformed numbers list here, and we have the even numbers list here. So we have three lists in total. And in the worst case scenario, which means if all the numbers in the original list are even, then I would have exactly three times the memory usage as compared to the original list on its own. And that's bad, right? I mean, of course, it's the worst case scenario because this list is most likely going to be smaller. But in the worst case, this list is not smaller. Now, the question is, how can I do that with an object that is similar to the map object? Well, we just use the filter built-in function. And the filter built-in function works just as the map built-in function. We pass it a reference to a function first, so isEven. And then I pass it, in this case, a sequence, a list. However, as we will see in the documentation, where is it? It takes an iterable. So it doesn't matter if we give it a list or a tuple or something else. As long as we can iterate over the argument, that's enough. So see how nicely you are now able to read the Python documentation, because again, the Python documentation focuses more on the behavior of an object and not on the type. So now I execute this code cell and store the results in events. And now what is events? Well, events is a filter object, and that works exactly like the transformer object down here. I don't draw it in the memory diagram. But what we know is the filter object is just one object in memory that spits out one by one the elements. So transformed numbers, just for a reference, that's the list of numbers that exists materialized in memory. And we see that we pass transformed numbers to the filter object. So let's now go over the filter object with the next built-in. So I get the next even number. And the next even number is, of course, the 50. The next even number would be 122, so I get back to 122. And now the next number, 65, this one is skipped, so I get back to 26. So the filter object just loops over the sequence we gave it one by one, and it only gives us back the numbers that fulfill the search criterion, which was is even. So also for this object, I can loop over it until the end, now 82. The next one will be 2, so the 101 is skipped. And now there is technically one more element, the 17, in it. However, this will not get given back to us because it's not even. So when I now hit enter again, I get a stop iteration error because the filter object is now out of elements. Okay, so now we have seen two ways to do transformations, mappings, and filterings without, you know, having a copy of the data in memory. So that's a huge improvement, and this is important to know when you want to work with big data. And whenever we are given such a filter object or a map object and we want to really materialize all the elements into memory simultaneously, we can always just wrap the function with the list constructor. And now we get back the filtered list, and this would be the list here called even numbers. Yeah, and all the elements exist simultaneously. Now, why is this notation nice compared to the for loops? Well, one way that makes it particularly nice is I can now stack together the map and the filter. So in order to do both for loops in just one line of code, I can write this expression here and evaluate it, and I get back the same result. So here, starting from the original numbers, I first do the mapping, and then I do the filtering second. And then once the filtering is done, the list constructor here does the materializing of the individual objects. So maybe this one line may be hard to read, and whenever you find yourself, you know, with a line of code that is maybe a little bit too nested, so you cannot really see right away what's going on, you can of course write it in a bit nicer way. So one nice way would be to do it like this. So let me just do it like this. So, and then usually, whenever we write something in this way, you would, for stylistic reasons, put a comma here and put the parenthesis, the closing parenthesis, on the next line. And so now we can already see that we evaluate this function calls from the inside out. It's a, you know, at the end of the day, it's just a composition from of callables. So first we do this, then we do this, and then we do this. And this, of course, is also legal in Python. So white space, as we know, is mostly ignored by Python. Only at some places, for example, in for loops or if statements, we do need to indent by 4 spaces or a number of spaces. So white space sometimes means something in Python, but as we see here, in this case, most of the white space, most of the line breaks is actually ignored. So this is exactly the same as not doing the line breaks. And now, why is this a way of writing nice? Well, first, I can express 2 loops in just one line of code. But second, I could also just go ahead and switch the 2 for loops, right? So let me also make this a little bit nicer. So if I go ahead and write it like this, I get back a different result. And the second result, the second code cell, is actually the exact same numbers that we saw first in chapter 4. And when we also when we first had a first little example of the map filter reduce paradigm, so I tend to reuse my examples. So that's why I have the example here that we already saw in chapter 4. And again, here, what is nice here, well, I can just basically switch the loops, and I can do that in one line of code, and everything is very compact. And these are stylistic and you know, code maintenance issues. But there's also another issue, which is, of course, speed. As we have seen, the for loop is definitely smaller, is definitely worse because it needs more memory. Here we don't need this intermediate memory. And also, what we maybe I should do that again. So what happens? Let's look at a new memory diagram to see what basically one or basically both of these code cells do? Well, first, we create a list of numbers again. And this list holds 12 numbers, 12 int objects. And this is called numbers. And then what happens, let's say I go ahead and assign here this here to the variable called result. So what now happens is, as this gets evaluated, what happens is the right-hand side of the assignment statement gets evaluated first, and then only the result is stored. So what that means is, what happens first is the filter object is created. So let's put it somewhere like here. We have the filter. And then the filter object, all it does, maybe I use a different color, it is given a reference to the function. So how do we do this? Let's basically, let's put two more objects here. So we have the function. So here's a function which is called transform. And then we have another function which is called, so func. And the other function is called isEven. So that's what we have in memory. And now what happens to this filter here? The filter is basically, all it does is it really holds like a reference to this isEven thing function, and also a reference to this object, but it's not yet executed. So in other words, the filter object only knows how to produce new numbers out of these numbers. That's the source, basically, with this function. But it doesn't do anything, right? So, and then what happens next in memory is the map object is produced. So let's put that here. So we have no idea what's inside here. It's only ones and zeros. So this would be the map. And what the map knows, the map, all it knows is, maybe let's use a different color here. The map is attached to the transform function because that's what it what it's given as the first argument, and it's also attached to the filter. So in other words, let's maybe write in a descriptive way here, source, and here is the F. And I mean with source, that's where the data is coming from. So this would be also the source, so to say, and this would also be the function that is applied. So this is now an intermediate state in memory. So this is what happens if the innermost line, the lines of code that I just marked here, when they have been evaluated, this is the state in memory that we have. So see, nowhere do we have any resulting numbers. So in other words, so far nothing happened. And what we see here is what we also call a lazy evaluation. So in other words, the objects that know how to calculate things, the rules, so to say, they exist in memory, but they haven't worked yet. So they are lazy, they are waiting for an instruction. And then we pass the entire expression here to the list constructor. And the list constructor is what we would call eager. So the list constructor says, well, I have to create a list. I'm sorry, you have to give me all your numbers. And so the list constructor goes ahead and creates a list. And let's maybe also put the type here, list, and also here, list. So the list constructor creates an empty list. And then what the list constructor does is the following. It talks to the map, and it says, because we passed this map object, we passed as the argument to the list constructor. So the list object asks the map object, hey, give me your next element, please. And then what does the map do? The map says, oh, I don't know, I don't have any elements. However, I know how to calculate them. So what the map does, it looks at its source, which is the filter object, and then the map object says, hey, filter object, can you maybe give me an element? And then the filter object says, OK, wait a minute, I don't have an element in me, but I know how to calculate one. And then the filter object goes ahead to the original list and says, hey, list, can you please give me your next element, which is the first one. And then the list goes ahead and gives the reference to the first element to the filter. And then the filter goes ahead and applies the filter function. And because the first number here is actually a 7, the filter will say, oh, I don't like this number. I cannot return it because the filter says I should not return the 7 because it's not even. And then the filter object says, hey, list object, can you give me your next number? And then the list object says, well, no problem. I give you the next number. And at some point, the list object will give back the filter object an even number. And when that is an even number, then the isEven function will confirm to the filter object, well, the number is even, you can spit it out. And then what the filter object does, it gives the even number to the map. And then the map says, OK, now I got an element to work with. So the map goes ahead and checks back with the transform function and to know how to transform it. So the map object sends the even number, the individual even number, to the transform function. The transform function creates a new function because it's mapping the element, gives it back to the map, and then the map finally gives the filtered, the even, and also the transformed number to the new list object. And then the list constructor just places it here. And then after that, the list constructor goes back to the map and says, give me your next element. And then the map says, well, I don't have one. So it asks its source. And then the filter object also says, well, I don't have one. And it asks this list. And then in this way, on a one-by-one basis, the objects that are in the list are up here. They move via the filter through the map into the new list object. So, and then at some point, we have a list object here, which possibly has less elements than the first one. And then what happens is, once this list here is done, once the list constructor has created the list, then in the code, the left-hand side of the assignment statement is evaluated, and we write the name result in the list of all names and make it reference the list. And then what happens is quite interesting, because we don't have a reference to these two objects. What happens is they just go away. They are just deleted, removed, because we don't have a reference. So in other words, the garbage collector just collects them, right? And then what we do is, what we did in this example, we went from this list to this list right away with no intermediate list. That's the important thing. So the memory consumption that is needed to go from this list to this list is minimal. Okay. So this is basically all the paradigm is about. It's about saving memory and being able to work with big amounts of data later on. Okay, and now comes the third step. The third step would be the reduction step, reducing. And what reducing means, we have also seen this before, this means then that, let's look at the original picture again. So we now have this list called even numbers. And we now want to do something with the individual numbers. We want to reduce those elements in the list into one summary statistic, so to say. That's what the reduction step does. So here, what I do is I pass the number here, this expression, that I actually had before. So it's actually, this is the exact same expression as this one here, as the inner one that I just passed to the list constructor. This now gets passed, for example, to the sum function, to the built-in sum function. And we can also, of course, make this look a little nicer, like this. And now the only thing that has changed is that instead of list here, we write sum. And what does the sum do? Well, it just sums up all the elements. In other words, maybe in order to stay, maybe to stay in this example here that we just did, here we use the list constructor to create this list here out of the original list. But what happens now in the code here is we go from this list via a filter object and a map object to an individual number. So we don't create a list, but we eventually spit out a single number. Okay, so this is what's happening here. And then let's see two other examples of a reduction. For example, calculating the minimum or the maximum. This would also be a reduction. So whatever operation we use to reduce a sequence of numbers into a single number, this would be a reduction. And sum, min, and max are typical examples. Okay, so again, I just summarize everything you see here does everything we have seen before in chapter 4, just without any intermediate lists, as efficient as possible. Okay, and now let's see how can we write reduction functions on our own. So we have written the transform function and the isEven function, so we were able to define our own mapping and our own filtering. And now I want to define my own reduction. And I don't want to use the built-in reduction functions, sum, min, and max. But so what we do here, just for illustration purposes, to understand how reduction works, we will re-implement the built-in sum function on our own. And we will call this function sumAlt for alternative sum. However, at the end of the day, this function will do exactly what the built-in function does. So this is not necessary to, or it will never be necessary to write this function in production code. But this is just for illustration purposes, because I think summing something up is something easy to understand. It's the easiest kind of reduction that there is. So let's see how does the reduction, what is reduction, how does it work? Well, reduction is a function that takes two arguments. So before transform mapping and filtering only take one argument, but here a reduction function takes two numbers. And the first element, the first argument is called sum so far, and the next one is called next number. So what we see here, and then what do we return? We return the sum of the two. So what that is, in a way, this is kind of like a running total. So we have an intermediate total, and we add on the next number, and then we return the old running total plus the number, so we return the new running total. In other words, this is a function that at the end of the day, as we will see, will incrementally update the running total, just as we saw in the very first example in chapter 1. So let's see how can we use that. So what I do here is I put together the filter and the map, and I store the entire object into an object called events transformed. So maybe we will also do that in a memory diagram. So, okay, we have our original numbers list again. So here we have and so on. Type is list, and that is numbers. So now what happens is we go ahead and we create a new filter object. So the filter object, let's put it, for example, here. So this is the filter. And the filter has, and also maybe let's put back in the two functions, isEven. So where do we do that? Let's put it here. We have isEven here and transform. So isEven is a function object. And then we have a second function object, which is called transform. And now what happens is the filter object we create is attached to the numbers list again. That's the source. And the filtering is basically connected to the isEven here. That's the F that goes to the map, to the filter. And then we create a second object. And this will be again of type map. And the map, let's use another color again, we'll use the filter as the source and the transform function as the F. And now what we do is we store that in a variable called events transformed. So I will write here events transformed, and I don't have to create a new object because the object I'm referencing is already created. It's this map. So this is the situation we have in memory. And then in addition to that, I will now create a new function. Let's put that here. And this function is called sumAlt. That's our own implementation of the, or re-implementation of the sum, of the built-in sum. This is the memory situation we have. And now I forgot to execute the events transformed. And now, what can we do? How do we use the sumAlt function? Well, here is just an intermediate step, only for didactical purposes. So in order to use a function like this that starts with a sum so far and always adds on a next number, this needs to have a starting value, right? And the starting value could, of course, be zero if we want to sum something up. But we can also take, for example, the first number that comes out of even transformed. So here, the first number that comes out of even transformed, we store in the variable called result. And then what we do is we loop over even transformed. And what the for loop does is it basically asks even transformed, the map object, to give out the numbers one by one. However, because we've already taken out the first number, the for loop will only start with the second number. And then inside the for loop, I print out something for didactical purposes, as we've seen before. And then within the for loop, what I do is I call our sumAlt function, and I pass in as the first argument the result. And as the, so the result is just in the first iteration of the loop, the first number. And then as the second argument, I pass in the current number in the loop, in the current iteration. And whatever the sumAlt returns, which is the, you know, the running total so far, will be stored in result. And then when we loop, when we go back up here and go through the second iteration in the loop, then result is not just the first number, but it's the sum of the first two numbers. And then we pass in the sum of the first two numbers into result. And then we add on the third number that we get from the loop. And we go on like this. So this for loop is just is basically looping over the filtered and transformed numbers without the first element, because we just got it out before. And if I do that, what happens is the result is basically calculated. So we can also see the total result is also 370. 370 is the result we have seen before. If you don't believe it, then we can just go back. And we see here is the 370. So our alternative implementation works. We also get back the same result here. And the important point to understand is, how does the sum function work? Well, the sum function works such that it always is given two arguments. The first one is an argument that is the sum so far, and the second one is the next number we want to add on. In other words, as we calculate the sum, we only have to track two numbers, the sum so far and the next number. And this is the trick that we apply so that we don't have to store all the numbers simultaneously. We just only store an intermediate sum and plus the next number we get from the map object, and we just add it on top. So summing is really, all summing is in computers or for programming is always a running total under the hood. It's always, because we can only add two numbers. And if we want to add 10 numbers, we have to add two numbers in a pairwise fashion until we added up all 10 of them. So that's how summation works in a reduction, or that's what a reduction step is. And the reason why I show this alternative implementation is that this is the generic way of how to implement a reduction function. So any reduction function will always take two arguments and return the argument that will then be passed in as the first argument in the next iteration of the loop. This is reduction. Okay. And now there is unfortunately no reduce construct in Python. So at least in core Python. So what we do is, from the standard library, there is a module called functools. And from that, we import a function called reduce. And then what we can do is we can use the reduce function just as we use the map and the filter built-in functions. So first, in this line of code, first we filter the numbers, then the filtered numbers get transformed, and then the transformed numbers are reduced to the sum. So we can also write this in maybe a nicer way. Okay. And then if I execute this code, of course I get back 370. Okay, so the only difference between the built-in reduction function sum and our own reduction function here is that we use the more generic way. And with the approach we used, we can use we can basically code up any reduction function we want. So any function that is capable of taking a sequence of numbers and reducing them into a single statistic. And how do we do that? All we need to do is we need to find a logic as to how to implement the reduction logic into a function that takes two arguments. This is the generic way of doing reduction. So this may be out of the three steps, map, filter, reduce, the reduction step may be the hardest to understand first when we want to do it in a generic way. But really what reduction is, just think of summing, minimizing, and maximizing. Okay, so this is an introduction to map, filter, reduce. And now throughout the next couple of sections, we want to fine-tune the map, filter, reduce and look at other data types that can also allow us to work in a similar fashion. And but first, let's look at lambda expressions. And lambda expressions is the last subsection of the map filter reduce paradigm that helps us to make the three steps that we just looked at even more concise. Now, what are lambda expressions? Lambda expressions, if you have read chapter 2, you already know what lambda expressions are. I skipped lambda expressions in the presentation of chapter 2 because chapter 2 was already quite lengthy. And back then, I did not have an application for lambda expressions. But now comes the application. But why are lambda expressions part of chapter 2? Well, lambda expressions at the end of the day is just a syntax to create a function object that does not have a name referencing it. So let's look at an example. So what I do here is I provide a lambda expression that does the exact same thing as our sumAlt function. So what does it look like? We will also look at the memory implications, of course. So what is the lambda expression? Lambda is a keyword, so it's just like def, for example. Just as we define a function object with def, we write lambda. And then what we do is we list the parameters of the function separated by comma, and we end the parameter list with a colon. So here's the colon. So that's the information that usually goes into the first line when we define a function. Now, what's missing here? Well, what's missing is obviously the name. So when we define a function, we give the function a name, and then we provide the list of parameters we specify for it. And here, we only provide the parameters without the name for the function. So in other words, what are lambda expressions intuitively? Well, they allow us to create anonymous function objects, functions without a name. So you may wonder, the whole point of having functions is to reuse them, right? That's what we learned in chapter 2. So we define functions to give names, descriptive names to fragments of code that we write. And the main purpose of functions is not only to give names to code, but also to reuse the code. And now I'm creating a function that does not have a name. So how can you reuse something that does not have a name? And the answer is the lambda expression syntax gives us a way of creating a function in a context where we don't want to reuse the function. So whenever we need a function syntactically for syntactic reasons, but we don't want to reuse the function, so we know ahead of time we only want to apply a function once and then we will not reuse it, then maybe a lambda expression is a better way as compared to a def statement, because then we don't have the side effect of creating a function object that sticks around even though we won't ever use it again. And then, how does the lambda syntax continue? Well, after the colon, we write the actual code from the function's body. But the rule is, we must only write there one expression. So when we define functions with the def statement, we can put as many lines of code in the body of the function. Here, in the lambda syntax, we can only write functions that consist of one line of code, basically. So here I just say sum so far plus the next number. And then also note, in the original definition, let's go back, where I reduced, where I defined the sum all function here, I have a return statement. So that's so I return the this expression. And in the lambda syntax, we don't see the return. And the reason for that is because lambda expressions only allow us to write one expression in the function's body, this expression will also be the return value. So yeah, that is just the return value here. So lambda, the lambda expression syntax is just a syntax to write to create functions without a name that are very short. We cannot write long functions with it. So let's create one. What happens? So I show you in memory what happens. I just evaluated this code cell. So what this does is, it creates an object with code in it of type function. I just write func for short, but it's type function. And now with the def statement, what we would do is we would write the function's name here and make a reference. But however, here, I don't have a reference because I didn't create the function with a def statement. The function does not have a name. So what would now happen after the code cell is executed? Well, what happens is this function gets basically forgotten right away. Why? Because we don't capture it in a variable. Okay. So the garbage collector at some point gets rid of it. So now, usually, when we write lambda expressions, we don't want to use such long variable names, even though the best practice when you write functions is to use parameters and also variables inside the function that are self-describing. Within the context of a lambda expression, the default is we just use short names. So in this case, I write the exact same function by just renaming the parameters into x and y. So if I execute this, what that would mean is another, a new function object will be created in memory, and we don't write a name here. So now, maybe just to show to you that I can actually call the function. How can I call this function? Well, let's copy-paste the function. And now I go ahead and I do a trick. I put the entire expression within parentheses. That's the grouping operator. And now I put another pair of parentheses. And what's that? That is the call operator. And now I want to add, let's say, two numbers. Let's say 1 and 2. And I execute this, and I get back 3. So what have I done now? I have created a function object, so as we say, on the fly. And I have immediately called it with 2 arguments. And then I get a return value from the function call. And after I got the return value, the function object itself is gone. It goes away because we don't have a reference to the function object. So in a way, what you see here is I can create functions without a name but still call them, even though they don't have a name. So, and in what context do I use them? Well, I use them, of course, in the map filter reduce context to basically, as we saw here in the, where is it? Here is one of the earlier pictures. And we have here a function called isEven, and we have another function called transform, And down here, I have a function sumAlt. And these functions all exist, and they all have names. And now what I want to do is I want to create the same diagram without names to the function objects. Okay, so let's do that. So, or in other words, how do I rewrite the entire example without giving names to the functions? Well, here's the first example. So I take here, this is the entire example. This is the entire logic of the example that I used in this first part here of this lecture today. So I create the list numbers new again, just to show you that this fourth line is also here. So it's a complete example. And then in the second line, I write filter. But note that I don't pass in a reference to isEvens here. Instead, I pass in a lambda expression, an anonymous function. And the function takes, of course, only one argument. This is the element. And then I return either true or false, because a filter function has to return either true or false. How do I do that? Well, I just write there a Boolean expression. So I divide x, the only argument to the function, modulo divide this by 2, and check if there is no rest. And if there is no rest, then I know that x must be even, in which case I just return the value to which the focused code now evaluates to, which is, of course, true. Right? So just to show you that, if, let's say, I have the number 6, and I modulo divide by 2, and I compare it to 0, I get back a true. And if I modulo divide the 7 by 2, I get back a false. So this is true or false. However, we have also learned that numbers evaluate or behave as if they are true or false in a Boolean context. And we refer to that as truthy or falsy in chapter 3. So we could also exploit this. But here I'm a bit more explicit. So I just compare the result of the arithmetic operation to 0, and that is then a Boolean expression. So I get back a true or false here, and I don't need the return keyword here because the only expression in the lambda function's body here will be returned. Okay, and then the second argument to filter is, of course, numbers. So this is basically exactly the same as if I wrote this, is even. That's exactly the same, but now I don't have, in this new formulation, I don't need to create a function with a name and pass this name to this filter function and then never ever use isEven again. So in this situation, I only create the lambda function on the fly, use it for filtering, and then immediately the function will be forgotten. And then in the next line, so the result of filters I store as evens, and in the next line, I go ahead and I use evens here. And in the map object, or in the map function, and the first argument to the map function is, of course, also a function that accepts one argument. And we also call that x here, but it's a different x than above. And then I return x squared plus 1. So I just do the transformation. And then in the last step, I just want to sum everything up. So I call the built-in sum function, and I pass it transformed. So in other words, the numbers list here, this creates 13 objects in memory, one list pointing to 12 int objects. And then the second line and the third line, they only create one object each, and the objects are of type filter and map, and these are rules in memory that somehow know how to filter and transform the numbers, but they don't do that. So up until everything that is now above the empty line, no calculations have been executed. So no filtering has happened and no mapping has happened. And then once I pass in transform to sum, so up until here, we would say all of this here is lazy. It hasn't done anything. This is an example of lazy evaluation. Nothing has happened. And then comes the sum function. And the sum function is what we said, what we described as eager. The sum function eagerly drives basically the lazy objects up here to go over all the numbers filtered and transformed one by one and sums them up. And we know, we remember in the background, summing a sequence of numbers is basically just an iteratively updated running total. And when I execute this, I get 370. So this is now basically three for loops. So except for the first line, of course, every line implicitly has a for loop behind. So this is like three for loops that I'm writing here without writing for. But it's not the for that we care about. It's about the implications in memory. So this is memory efficient. But the question is it? Let's look at another formulation of this. So what is different here? Well, because I know, and that's just maybe it's cheating a bit, but just because I know the numbers up here are the numbers from 1 to 12. They are just unordered. But I know that it's the numbers 1 to 12 and no number is missing. What I do down here is I replace numbers by the range object from 1 to 12. So the left index is including, the right index here is excluding. So these are the numbers from 1 to 12 in order. So okay, I go from unordered numbers to ordered numbers, but everything else is the same. And what have we learned about range? Already in chapter 4, we talked about how the range object is a rule in memory that can give us the numbers one by one without holding references to all the numbers simultaneously. So this is basically a memory-less way of going over to the numbers 1 to 12. It's as efficient as it can get in memory. And then the second and third line, they also don't cause any harm in memory, so nothing will be materialized in memory. And then the sum function just eagerly drives the entire object, or all the three rules that are stacked together. They are basically driven by the sum built-in. However, the sum built-in is also memory efficient because it only keeps track of two numbers at a time, namely the running total so far plus the next number in line. So in other words, this is as memory efficient as it gets. And if I execute this, I of course get 370. So now I promised you that in chapter 7, I promised you, no, in chapter 2 actually, I already showed you when we first looked at the average evens function. I promised you that I will show you a way of how to do all the arithmetic without having any, without using any memory, and that's the way to go. So now you may wonder, at what point in your programming career should you start doing this? I think this is not so trivial. I think the example that I've chosen can be easily understood. But if you want to apply the map filter reduce paradigm in practice, it's not so trivial. So in your first couple of coding exercises regarding this, you will probably just use a list or a tuple or whatever. And it's more about getting the code to work and understanding all the looping concepts we have looked at. But then eventually, when you want to scale up whatever code you write to big amounts of data, then you should think about replacing for loops with the map filter paradigm here, or the map filter functions. So in other words, I think by now, most students in this course, they are super familiar with the for statement or the for loop. They don't like the while loop so much, even though the while loop is also rather trivial. But the for loop is usually your go-to thing when you want to repeat some code. But at the end of the day, I think a good practice is to get rid of for loops. And when we are in chapter 9 and talk about array and data frame data, then there's also this best practice that everyone keeps telling you, that when you work with arrays of data and data frames of data, you should not use the word for, the for statement, because it's inefficient. And usually it's inefficient for two reasons, and both memory-wise, but also computationally, the speed of the for statement is also not so good as here for the filter and map functions. So at the end of the day, this is what you should aim for in the long run. But in the short run, when you're still studying, I think this could be a little bit too hard. But maybe you have understood it now, everything, and you can just start working with these concepts. And now, also just to show you how these concepts can be visualized. So whenever we want to visualize something, I will show you how we can do that in a nice way in Python Tutor. So here, Python is the very first implementation, the naive implementation, the implementation that you would have probably done if I had told you to solve the problem. So here we define two functions, isEven and transform. We generate a list called numbers. It's a list object, so it contains the numbers 1 to 12, materialized. Then we create an empty list evens. Then we loop over the numbers. Then we append to evens. And then in the next line, we create a list transform, which is empty in the beginning. We loop over evens. We append the transformed numbers. And then at the end, we sum up. So we already see it's 116 steps, so I go over it rather quickly. So first, let's create the function objects. Then we create the materialized list. And now we create the empty list evens. And now what we do is we go over the for loop here. And then eventually, we see that the list slowly builds up. And this is, of course, the filtered list. So the list slowly builds up. And in the worst case scenario, if we are given only even numbers, this list would be as big as the first list. And now we go to the second loop. So now the transformed list builds up. And so maybe just shortly before the end, now we have three lists in memory. And in the worst case scenario, the second and the third list are just as long as the first one. And then we go over the last list, and we reduce it to one number, which is the 370, which we have seen before. So that's the memory implication. So even with Python Tutor, you can actually see what goes on in memory, and you can actually tell that the way we solve this problem here is not memory efficient. And then to contrast this, here is the last example that I showed you in the presentation. And now let's see what happens in memory here. Well, in the extreme case, I just use the range built in without materializing it. So there's no list around it. So we just have the range object here. And then we build up a new object called events, which is of type filter. So we have a new object, events. And then in the third line we execute, we now create a map object called transformed. So it's also a map here. And so far, the interesting thing is, nothing has happened in memory. This is like, we don't have a single number in memory at this moment, right? We only have the range object, which will be the primary source for the data. We will have the filter object that knows how to filter the source. And then we have the map object, which knows how to transform the filtered numbers. But at the end of the day, so far in memory, we don't have a single number. And now comes the eager sum function, the reduction step, which basically drives all of the calculations. And now we see here an own namespace, a local scope, which goes by the name lambda. So what that means is whenever a lambda expression is executed, then at the end of the day, this is a function that is executed, which is why we see a function scope here. But the function does not have a name. We didn't name the function here isEven or transform. And because of that, this function is anonymous. And Python Tutor shows this with just the lambda symbol here. So now we can go over this, and we see how the loops go here. But we see that so far, nothing has really materialized. But this is actually a white lie. So I'm sorry. This is actually absolutely correct. So nothing has materialized so far. So the only thing that sum does, it keeps track of the running total and the next number in line, which it gets from the rules up here. So at most, we have two numbers in memory simultaneously. And then when we reach the end, we will, of course, also get 370. So we just saw a way where with at most two numbers in memory, we can calculate the result to be 370. Okay, so let's continue in the presentation. So let's go on. Or maybe sometimes you also write that in just one line here, one expression. But then what you also could do is we could also make this look a little nicer. No, this was the wrong parentheses. So could maybe write it like this. And or even to be a bit more extreme, so this maybe is the most extreme version of writing this. So we see from the inside out, we take the numbers 1 through 13, we filter them, we map them, and then at the end we sum them up. This is all only one expression. We don't need any temporary variable here, even though using temporary variables here is really not bad, because we have seen that temporary variables or any variables in Python are just references, so they are super cheap to create. Everything is just fine. But also we get back a 370 here. Okay, and now that was the map filter reuse paradigm, and now we look at something that we have also seen before in the first chapter, which is called a list comprehension. And list comprehension are one way of why Python oftentimes looks very similar to math. So let's see an example. We start with the numbers list again. And now we want to do both the transformation and the filtering in one step. Can we do that in one for loop? We could, actually. And we have done that in chapter one. So we loop now over the numbers. And then in every iteration of the loop, I filter for the even numbers. And only the even number gets transformed here. And the transformed number gets appended to the list evens transformed. So let's do that. And then evens transformed contains all the even and transformed numbers. And these are the same numbers that we saw in chapter four already. And now, how can I rewrite this? Well, I can rewrite the entire for loop. That's an explicit for loop here with the for statement. I can rewrite this as a list comprehension. And what the list comprehension really is, whenever you find yourself in a situation where, semantically speaking, we want to express the idea that we start with a list and we want to derive a new list out of an existing list, then we do that. So we write the brackets here, but within the brackets, the literal notation for the list, we don't just write the individual elements, but we write an expression that allows us to calculate the individual elements. And basically, what this means is we have a for number in numbers, and then we have the if here. And so we just use the same logic. And all we do is write the transformation, the number squared plus one. We take this and put it in the front. And here I say n squared plus one to make it a bit shorter. And then comes the for loop, and we write it as for n in numbers. And then comes the if statement, the filter, and we write it as if n modulo divided by 2 equals 0. And if I execute this, I also get the same list. So this is how we get a list comprehension out of a loop. We just use whatever the expression is that we want to append to the new list, and we take that to the front, and then we write the for loop here. And then if there is an if statement, that does not have to be one. So it's also possibly the case that we don't want to filter something out, then we would just leave away the if here. This also works without here. But this is like the full version. And whenever this may be confusing, we will see an example of where we have two nested for loops shortly. One thing I can already say is whatever is the logic in an explicitly written for loop is the same order in the list comprehension. People sometimes get confused, as you will see later, but it's really just copy-pasting the explicit for loop down within the list comprehension. But now, this has two advantages. One is, this here is a little bit faster than this implementation. Why is that? Well, primarily because when we create an empty list, what Python does in memory, it creates, let's say, there should be around 8 slots. And then what Python does is, or what we do here is, so we create an empty list, and then we append a single number at a time. And let's say the following happens. So we put in more references here. And let's say now the array that holds all the references is now full. And now let's say the for loop is not over yet. What happens is, the dot append will be executed one more time. And then what Python does when it runs out of space in the list, it does not go ahead and make the list larger. This does not work like this, unfortunately. So what Python does instead, it goes ahead and creates a totally new list with a longer array. And we'll then go ahead and create new boxes or down here, or basically, in this case, it will actually go ahead and just keep those boxes, and then also create new boxes, right? And then Python will automatically get rid of the smaller array and will only keep the bigger one. And the reason for that is Python in the beginning just does not know how many data will go into the list. And it has to make a guess, and the guess will most likely be wrong. So because of that, because Python in maybe has to like copy all the elements that are already in the list again, because the list is too short, this is a big reason why the first line of code, or the first code cell here, may be slower in practice. That's the first reason why I don't like this code cell. And the second one is, really, when we try to express the idea that there is an old list and I want to derive a new list out of the old list, then I think this way of writing it expresses this idea a lot better, because then we say, well, here here what I'm expressing is, well, somehow I need an empty list and then I repetitively execute some code. I have no idea what's really going on here, but here I really express the idea that we create a new list, and then the list is derived by some rule from the old list called number. So it's this code is a lot nicer to read in the long run, and it's faster. And then, of course, what can I do with list comprehensions? I can just use a list comprehension and put them, for example, within any place where I would otherwise use a list object. So if I want to sum up a list, I would just call sum with a list passed in, but I could also write in there a list comprehension and execute this, and I get back the same 370. So let's see another example. This is called working with Cartesian products. And this will show you how you can how we work with nested for loops. So what is a Cartesian product to begin with? Imagine you have two independent sets of objects. So first of all, here we have a set X, which has the X's, X1, X2, and X3. And then we have a second set of things, the Y's, called Y1, Y2, Y3. A Cartesian product is any transformation that we apply to the any combination of X's and Y's. So we see that we apply a transformation to X1, X2, but also to Y1 and X2 and to all the combinations. And whenever you will go ahead and we have a set of things and another set of things, and we do something for every combination, for every two-tuple that consists of one element from the one set and the other element from the other set, then we call this a Cartesian product. And of course, I have here a Cartesian product derived from two sets, but the idea of a Cartesian product also extends to more than just two sets. So we can have a Cartesian product derived of, you know, from five different lists or so on. And let's see an example. So the example would be this. Give me a set. So the task is to calculate a set which is derived from the X's and Y's with the following function. Uppercase pi, which is basically like the summation sign that we know from statistics. The only thing that's different is the pi, the uppercase pi means multiplication. So that means I want to multiply all the numbers here, basically. So I want to do the following transformation. I want to divide x by y, and I want to add 1 to it, and then I end up with a table of 9 numbers, and these 9 numbers I want to multiply. So this will then look like this. So for example, let's take the numbers 10, 20, 30, and 40, 50, 60 here. So how do I calculate this 1.25 here? Well, this is just 1 plus 10 over 40. And this next number would be 1 plus 20 over 40, so which is 1.5. And then the set would be defined as the multiplication of all of them. So the product of all the 9 numbers here. So, and whenever you find yourself, so what do we see here? We also see map filter reduce here, right? So what is the filter? Well, there is no filter. So, I mean, not having a filter is also of course, legal in the map filter reduce paradigm. What is the map? Well, the map is given here by this formula. And what is the reduction? Well, the reduction is the product of the 9 elements here. So before, we have seen 3 kinds of reductions. We have seen the sum, we have seen the min and the max, and now we see the product as the reduction. So how do we implement this with a list comprehension? Let's first go ahead and create 2 lists. And then I want to go ahead and create the Cartesian product. So how do I create the Cartesian product here? Well, a first naive implementation would be to start with an empty list and then numerate over the list first, and we call every element in first the numerator. And then we, within the for loop, we have a second for loop, a nested for loop, and we loop over all the numbers in second. We call that the denominator. And then we calculate the quotient by, you know, just numerator divided by the denominator. And then the actual number that we want to multiply by is 1 plus the quotient. Yeah, so I should really, in line with the formula, maybe say 1 plus the quotient. And then what do I do with 1 plus the quotient? Well, I append it to the Cartesian product list. And I get back the Cartesian product, and these are all the numbers that are in the table. And now the next step would be, so this is, what step is that? That is the mapping step. And again, there is no filtering. I just want to map here. And then what is the next step? It's the reduction step. So I want to multiply them all together. Oh no, let's do something first. How can I write this in a nicer way? How can I write this with a list comprehension? Well, as we have seen before, I just write opening brackets and closing brackets, the list literal. I have here the transformation. So it's x over y plus 1, and again, this should maybe be 1 plus x over y. And the parentheses are not really needed, but it looks a little nicer here. I think it's easier to read. And then the question is, how do we put the fours inside? Well, we have 2 for loops here, nested. So we just write for x in first, for y in second. So this is what I meant by sometimes people get confused when you write list comprehensions. So people often ask the question, so in what order should the fours go? Well, if you have a hard time to figure that out, just write out in your head the for loop explicitly, just as we do up here. And then you just use the same order within the list comprehension. And of course, we would use X and Ys to keep everything a bit more concise. And if I execute this code cell, then I get the exact same list. So this is basically nicer. And this also conveys the idea that I start with 2 sets, so to say, or 2 lists of objects. And then I derive out of them the Cartesian product with some transformation. And then, of course, if you switch the 2 fours, you get a different result, right? So you have the order matters. But of course, if we switch the order up here, the order of the 2 loops up here, then we would just divide in the wrong order, so to say. So the denominator becomes numerator and vice versa. So what can we do now with this list comprehension? Well, we want to multiply them together, so we need a product function. And remember, in the towards the end of the first part of chapter 7, when we talked about tuples and about unpacking and packing in particular, we came up with this example, a function called product, which takes 1 argument called args. And what is args? Well, args is going to be a tuple. And how do we know that? Because of the asterisk here. So what the asterisk is, it means we can pass in as many arguments as we want to product, and they are all collected, packed, so to say, into 1 tuple. And then what we do is we loop over, we take the first element and tuple and loop over the rest, and we multiply them all together. So we the first number is the first element just is the first result, and then we iteratively multiply on all the numbers. And of course, the loop starts with the second number in args. But you should look at this in detail in the first part of chapter 7, and also in the exercises There is one exercise that extensively deals with this function and still will enhance this function pretty much. So what can we do with that? Well, I can, of course, pass in the list comprehension to the product function. However, the product function is built, so let's maybe put in another cell here, code cell, to see how does the product function work. Well, the product function, for example, it would take just one number, and the product of just one number is the number itself. And if I go ahead and put in, let's say, two more numbers, then the product of those numbers should be 500 here, and indeed it's 500. So because of the star in the definition, in the parameter definition here, I can pass in as many arguments as I want by position only. So we will see a similar thing in chapter 8, but here we can pass in the arguments only by position. And in order to do that, coming from a list object, which I have here with the list comprehension, I have to unpack the list. And how do I unpack a list? We also saw that in the first part of chapter 7. We unpack with the asterisk. So the asterisk means here unpacking, and here it means packing. And so if you don't know how this works, you should review some of the materials in part 1 of chapter 7. But I told you back then that I like to use these asterisks because the packing and unpacking syntax really makes code look nicer, and it's also a faster way to code at the end of the day. So let's calculate the product by unpacking the 9 numbers into the product function, and we get back the product of 20.58. And now I can, this is just an example to illustrate some point further. We could, of course, also use a lambda expression with the reduce function to also do the same. And actually, there is a big difference here. So maybe let's do let's try live coding. So what I mean by that is we go to Python Tutor. And because I did not prepare this, so let's copy paste the product function here and then see something. So first we put in the example with unpacking the list comprehension. Or maybe let me wait. I just remember that this example is not yet done. We will look at this example later, so in, let's say, 15 minutes, when we have learned about another data type, so that I can contrast three different data types. But just remember that we can also use here the reduce built-in. So, and that's the other data type I wanted to talk about, generator expressions. So to summarize the section before, we can use list comprehensions to derive lists out of lists that are given, to express the idea that we derive a list out of lists, and then we can use list comprehensions syntactically wherever we can just use lists. Just as I unpack a normal list here, I could unpack the list comprehension. And now comes something very similar to list comprehension, namely generator expressions. And the difference between a list comprehension and a generator expression is just that a generator expression is just as a list comprehension, just it's lazy. So we know that lists, by now, they materialize all their elements into memory. And that is sometimes what we want, sometimes it's not what we want. And sometimes we want our code to evaluate lazily, to not not put all the numbers, in this case, into our memory. And in order to write lazy code, we use a generator expression. So what is a generator expression? Let's look at an example, the numbers list. And here is, our transformed and filtered numbers. This is just from 5 slides ago. So I get back the same numbers as we know from chapter 4 onwards. And now here I have obviously a list comprehension, which we see with the brackets. So how can I make the list comprehension into a so-called generator expression? Well, It's very easy. I just replace the brackets with parentheses. And now you would think, oh, wait a minute, what does the parentheses mean? Parentheses, usually for us, we have seen them in many ways. And your first response here would probably be that the parentheses are something like the grouping operator. And if this were the grouping operator, it would be absolutely pointless, because why would you put parentheses around one entire expression? This is basically useless. But in this situation, the parentheses have yet another meaning, namely they create a generator expression. So let's execute this cell, and I get back a so-called generator object. Now, what is that? Well, it has to have something in common with what we talk about in this part two of chapter seven all the time. And what is the main message of this part two of the chapter seven here? Well, the main message is that we can create rules in memory that know how to calculate stuff without calculating it. And that is what a generator expression is. So in other words, I can go ahead and, for example, pass the generator expression. The generator expression is just a rule. So what this means is we generate these numbers here one by one. And that's what I mean with the list comprehension is eager. The list comprehension materializes all the numbers in memory. And the generator expression, it creates a generator object which knows how to create these numbers but does not yet create them. And how can we basically pull out all the numbers from the generate expression? Well, we, of course, use the list constructor again. So we wrap the list constructor around the generator expression, and I get back the list with the same numbers. Okay, so this is basically, again, as I said, it's just a list. It's basically like a list, just lazy. And now one thing that is nice: whenever a generator expression is the only argument to a function, then what we can do is we can get rid of one pair of parentheses here. So we have the outer parentheses. What are they? These are the call operator, so we are calling the list constructor. Then comes the second pair of parentheses. That is the syntax to create the generator expression. And here, the third pair of parentheses is just grouping here the n squared, which we don't really have to, because the exponentiation operator goes before the addition anyways, but I do that for better readability. So now the second parentheses we can just get rid of, and also the second to last we can get rid of, and now I run this again and I get the same output. And so this is nice. So I can just write in, that means I can basically write a generate expression as the only argument to a function all the time, and we will do that. You will see that done very often, and this makes Python look very nice. So what we know is, well, how can we read this now? This basically says that we have an object here inside that is a rule that knows how to calculate objects, and then the list constructor out here that pulls all the objects out and materializes all the objects. And instead of, for example, the list constructor, we can use, for example, a reduction function like the sum function. So let's call sum, and it gives us back 370 again. So what's the difference between having, let's say, a list comprehension in here and not having a list comprehension? Well, let's now maybe go to Python Tutor, because now this this really makes sense to see the difference. So I copy paste that in. I copy paste the same expression without the brackets. And then somehow we also need numbers, of course, because Python Tutor will not know otherwise what is numbers. So, and now let's visualize this code. So now, at first, we create the list numbers. Or maybe let's edit this code. Let's not do this, but let's just write it as range 1 to 13. So let's also be lazy here. I like being lazy because it saves lots of memory. So in the first step, we create a range object that knows how to create the numbers 1 through 12 without creating them. And now I write sum and I put in a list comprehension, and the list comprehension does the entire map reduce. So it filters the numbers, it filters for even numbers, and it transforms them. And then the entire numbers get passed to the sum function, and then the sum is calculated. So what happens? So what happens is, first, the list comprehension runs. This makes sense. And then, at some point, a list materializes, and that's already a hint that something that is something we don't want. So what that means is, in order for the sum function to work, in the last step before the sum function is being started, a fully materialized list object exists in memory. And then, of course, the sum function will return 370, okay? And now let's look at the other sum function, the second call, where I replace the list comprehension by a generator expression. And now what happens? So we go over the numbers 1 to 12 again in a lazy fashion. And let's see if there is a list created. No. So see the difference? So when we run the second argument, no list object is created. No list object materializes. But if I go back a bit, the first call to sum with the list comprehension inside, this creates a list. This materializes a list. So we have to be careful now. If we really want to store memory or save memory, then it's always better to use generate expressions in place of list comprehensions wherever possible. So in this situation here, it's possible. So now, with the list comprehension, I get 370. And if I get rid of the brackets to make it a generated expression, I also get 370. OK. But the second time, so this version, is a lot better in memory. So now the question you wonder, maybe, how in the world do you know this? Well, now I told you this, and now you know. There are not many more rules, not many more situations where you can, by accident, do this, but you have to know at some places where you know there could a list being be materialized, and whenever you write a list comprehension, there will be a list somewhere in memory. So that means some, at one instant of a second, or one instance of a moment is maybe the better term, in your computer program, you will need lots of memory to hold all the reference to all the int objects, in this case, simultaneously. If you use a generate expression, this does not happen. So you only go over the numbers one by one, and you add them up in a running total way. And then at most, you have two numbers in memory. So this version is super memory efficient. And with a list comprehension, it's not memory efficient. But sometimes you need to have a list, right? And whenever you need a list, then you can, of course, use the list comprehension. So let's look at the generators a bit more in detail. So let's create a new generator expression and store it with gen. So let's do that. So what this does in memory is it does the following. Let's create a new memory diagram here. And what happens is this will, of course, also assume that we have our numbers list somewhere in memory. And then we create a new object, gen. And what is gen? We don't know what's inside. It's some ones and zeros inside. But it's of type generator. I abbreviate it with gen. And in this case, we also call it, we give it the name gen. And so what is the generator object? Well, just like we had with the map and the filter objects before, the gen object takes numbers as its source. And basically, what a generator is, it's a rule. So now we have created a rule in memory that somehow does, in this situation, the same calculations as the map and the filter. So now this is like the two objects we had previously, the map and the filter together in one. But we can have any rule in here, right? Any rule that we create in a generator expression can be put inside the generator here. And so far, nothing has happened. And now what we can do is, so now first we have a generator object, which is stored in memory at this location here. It's of type generator. And now what can I do? I can use Python's built-in next function to draw out the next number. So for example, the 65. So basically, I go ahead in memory and say, hey, can you give me the next number that you know about? And then the rule says, well, sure. And then the rule talks to the list and says, give me your next number, which is the first. And then it does the filtering and the transforming. And then it creates the 65. And then what happens in this situation here, it gives it back as output. And because we don't store it away, what happens is the object gets immediately forgotten. And then if I go ahead and call next again with gen, then the generator is being asked, hey, give me please your next number. And then the generator talks to its source and gets the next number. And the next number in this scenario would be 145, of course, also an integer. And then because we don't store it away, the integer is returned to us in Jupyter Notebook as the output. And then because we don't store it away, it's immediately forgotten and goes away. And if we ask the generator, give me the next object, then we would get the next one, in this case, the 5. And now let's guess what's going to happen if the generator runs out of objects to produce. Let's see what happens. We get a stop iteration error. We are familiar with that. It's the same behavior as the map and the filter objects. Okay, and the technical term that we would use here is we would say that the generator is now exhausted. That's the official terminology here. Okay, and now let's go back to the Cartesian products example and also use a generator expression here. And then we will quickly go to Python Tutor one more time to see a second area or a second situation where we have to be a little bit careful. So let's redo the example. And instead of three lists that contain the numbers 10 through 60, the materialized versions, I use the range built in to be memory efficient. And now what I can do, I can pass in the generator expression to the product function and unpack it. Remember that in the first time I showed you this example, at this stage we had the I can actually copy paste it and reproduce it here. We had a list comprehension, so the parentheses were like this. So we had brackets here. So what we do here is we have a list comprehension that does all the calculations for the Cartesian product, and then it materializes all the numbers in memory. And then at the end, before the function is run, the list with all the numbers, which are 9 numbers, gets unpacked by the unpacking operator here. And then the product function, on the other hand, also has the asterisk, which does the packing. So the unpacked numbers from the list comprehension, get packed into what? Well, the answer is, of course, into a tuple, because that's how functions work. And then the function works and runs, and it gives us back the result 20.58. And then we could, of course, now think, and that's the second situation I mean where you have to be careful. So you have now by now understood that when we use the brackets, there will be a materialized list. So we need lots of memory. It's bad. And then your first intuition would be to replace the brackets with parentheses to use a generator expression. Because I just showed you that a generator expression is a rule that gives us the numbers on a one-by-one basis. However, and that's a bit of unfortunately, you can already see that I wrote a note here so that I must not forget to tell you this. This is not memory efficient. And why not? Because I'm using the unpacking here. So whenever you have a generator and you unpack it, well, what happens is you have to, you know, unpacking means you draw out all of the numbers in it. And they get stored within a tuple inside the function. But the thing is, they are stored inside the function as a tuple, materialized. So this, unfortunately, means that using a generated expression instead of a list comprehension does not automatically lead to a memory efficient solution. We also get back 20.58, but this is not memory efficient. So now let's see, how can I make this memory efficient? And here comes the reduce function again from the functools module in the standard library. And now it pays off if you understood what the reduce function does. And it also pays off that you understood what the lambda expression does, because now we are doing everything in a memory efficient way. And the reason is that in order for the product function to work, it has to, you know, pack all the values that are unpacked into it into one materials tuple. But the reduce function, takes an anonymous function here, the lambda expression, which takes two arguments, which is, the in this case, the product so far plus the next number. And then it multiplies the product so far times the next number. And yeah, this way, we don't need all the numbers. We basically calculate a so-called running product in memory. And now the question is, where does the reduce function get its data from? Well, the second argument is the source. And the source is now also a generator expression, because you don't want to use, as the second argument here, a list comprehension, because we learned that a list comprehension will materialize all the numbers, no matter what you do. So we cannot use a, or we must not use a list comprehension here. So we have to use the generator expression. And that means that the reduce function now lazily, or the reduce function actually is eager, but it asks the generator, give me your next object. It gets the next object, and it multiplies the objects together and on a one-by-one basis. So it keeps on multiplying on, so to say, the next number produced by the generator. And this way, we don't have to have all the numbers simultaneously in memory. And this also gives us back 20.58. And now maybe it's time to copy-paste this. Where is it? Here it is. Copy-paste the three versions here. So we see all of that together, maybe in Python Tutor. Maybe I should also correct my spelling. Result, and this has been a long lecture, so okay, so this is now the second version, and let's also use the third version to compare all of them, how they work in memory. Okay, and for this to run, we also need from the functools module in the standard library, the reduce function. And then ideally, we must also not forget here that we define first and second. And I define it with the help of the range built in, so that we are super memory efficient here. And now let's see if I made a mistake. It seems to work. So let's quickly go over this, and I will just summarize everything I just said with a nice image now. So we import reduce, we create first and second, which is memory-less because it's the range object. Then I create the reduce, the product function, with the packing operator. And packing means we can pass into product as many arguments as we want. And then within the function, args is a tuple of all the arguments I passed in. In other words, args is materialized. And then now let's run three different versions. So first, the first version is I derive the nine numbers to be multiplied with a list comprehension, and I unpack this. So let's go ahead and do this. So we see the list comprehension starts to run. And then, now I was too fast. So the list comprehension starts to run. And now we have for an instant of a second, I have a list of all the numbers. Unfortunately, these numbers now all exist simultaneously, so a materialized list. And now what happens next, in the next moment, is this list, the numbers in the list gets unpacked into the product function, but the product function packs them together into args. So now we see that now with the list scope goes away and the product scope will appear. And the product scope now has one name called args, and this references a tuple, which now has all the numbers, but nevertheless, all the numbers are materialized. So the list, by the way, is now gone, but it must have been somewhere in memory. And now the product function will just loop over everything here and produce the result. That was the first version. So this was memory efficient at two situations. First, it created a list, and then it created a tuple, both materialized. Now we look at the second version, the formulation with the generator expression, where we unpack the generator expression. So let's go over it. The generator expression runs. It has, of course, its own scope. And then at some point, the generator expression will be done. And what then happens, the product function gets called, and it it packs the individual numbers provided by the generator expression. They first get unpacked as arguments, and then they get packed together in a tuple. So they all also exist simultaneously in memory. That's also bad. It's a little improvement. Before that, we had a list and a tuple, and now we only have a tuple. And now let's look at now the calculations run again. And it's gone. And now let's do the third way. The third way is, of course, the best way, the reduce function. And what it does is it first produces the generator expression as a second argument. And then the reduce function on a one-by-one basis pulls out the numbers from the generator and passes them to the reduction function, which is a lambda expression. And the lambda expression multiplies on a running product, so to say, the individual numbers. And we will see this. And so let's go back one more time. And now I start running the third expression here, the third line. And we will see that hopefully at no point in time do I have a materialized tuple or list or anything. So far I haven't seen any yellow, and we are right at the end. So we have seen the third way. Indeed, it does not need a tuple, and it also does not need a list. So the third way is the only way that is memory efficient. And so you may wonder, why could I not write a nice function like the product function? Why do we have to use this weird lambda expression as a reduction function with two arguments and so on? Well, it really pays off to understand that once you start to work on big data sets. Okay, so now let's continue the presentation. And now with everything we have learned so far, what I want to do is I want to take a look at our very first example in this course, averaging even numbers, that we also looked at in chapter 2 when we looked into what are functions. And we defined a function called average evens that was pretty well back then, but it was not memory efficient. And now, just to reiterate the point here, how you can use all of what you learned in this chapter and put it together to reformulate your function from chapter 2 in a way that is super memory efficient. So what do we do here? Average evens still takes numbers. Numbers used to be a list. So in the doc string, we used to write that numbers is supposed to be a list, but now we know more about Python. So we know that the only two properties that we need for the function to work is we need that the first argument, the numbers argument, is iterable, and it also has to be finite. Because if we want to calculate the average of something, then whatever data we want to calculate the average of better be finite. We cannot average up an infinite stream of numbers. So these are the two properties that we rely on. And that's also duck typing at work in a way, right? So I don't say, give me a list or something. I just say, give me something I can iterate over and that is finite. And then the scalar we also have, but we can ignore it for now. And then what happens in the first line? we have here on the right-hand side a generator expression. This used to be a list, or a list comprehension to be precise, but we now know that we don't want to use a list here or a list comprehension because we know that lists always materialize and we don't want to materialize. So I write a generator expression that loops over the numbers one by one and just rounds the numbers. So remember that average evens only make sense for integers. So if a user provides a data stream of floats, then we round the floats to get integers. And then we store this generator expression in a variable called integers. And integers is then a generator object. And then we write a reduce step. So we use by using the reduce function from the functools module in the standard library. And now it's a little bit tricky here. And this is actually, I would say now, a little bit advanced, but it's still on a conceptual level easy to understand. So what we do is, let's look at the second part here. So we reduce takes two arguments. First, a function, which we provided with a lambda expression. And then the second argument is the source for the reduce step, which is another generator expression. And this other generator expression here derives from the first generator expression. And then we loop over the individual numbers and we filter them. And then instead of returning the numbers as n, we return a tuple n comma 1, and we use the comma 1, the second element in this tuple, to implement the counting, because you know, to get an average, we have to sum something up and then count, divide by the count. And we have to also keep track of some count somehow, and we cannot use the len function because unfortunately, generator objects don't know how long they are, because generator objects, they only know one thing, which is how to get the next object, but they don't know how many objects there are. And so because of that, with this trick, with a tuple here, we have the actual number we want to sum up for averaging, and then we add up the ones, and for every for every number that remains, for every even number, we just add up one all the time, and that means we just take the count. And then in the last step, I just divide the total by the count and multiply by the scalar, and this is it. So up until here, the function is lazy, and only the reduce function will eagerly drive all the generator expressions. And if we look at this implementation now, I can, of course, call average evens with our familiar numbers list here, get 7.0. We can, of course, also put in the numbers as floats. It also works. We could also go ahead and, of course, as seen in chapter 2, provide a scalar of 2 to get 14. It also works. And now maybe let's do a little experiment. Let's import the random function. And now what do I do? I pass to the average even function another generator expression. And the generator expression is basically a big loop that loops 10 million times and then produces in every iteration of the loop a random number, a random integer between 0 and 100. And we know that the numbers between 0 and 100, if they are equally likely, we should have an expected value of around 50. When we run, when we draw many random numbers between 0 and 100. So let's call this function. And I can already tell you that if we wanted to materialize a list that is this big, this will most likely, this could actually crash my laptop because my laptop does not have so much space. But I mean, this wouldn't actually, because 10 million is not so much, but we can imagine that I can increase this number easily by a little bit to get my laptop to crash. So in order to calculate the average, now the cell is already running, to calculate the average of something that does not fit into my computer's memory, how do I do that? Well, the trick is, and now you can guess it by now, we just loop over the things we want to average one by one so that they fit in memory. And now we see that the average of all the events between randomly drawn numbers between 0 and 100 is around 50. So this makes sense. So what's an application of this? Well, let's say you are a company that is a big corporate, and you have lots of sales data, and you want, for example, to calculate, you know, the average amount of a sale. Let's say you are like a retailer, like Lidl or Aldi or something, and you have many small sales, but you have really many, and you want to have an what is the average, the average basket that is sold. Then how would you do that? Well, probably, you know, a company like Lidl or Aldi has so much sales that it doesn't fit into a computer's memory. But by going over the numbers one by one, we can calculate the average of something. We could also calculate the standard deviation and variation of something that doesn't fit in memory. So we can easily see that a company with big data can make use of that. Okay. So let's talk about something simpler. So reduction functions, as we have seen, are examples for that are like the sum, the min, the max function, but also the product function, for example, that we have seen. Let's look at a different kind of reduction functions, so-called Boolean reducers. And that seems to be a fancy term, but it's very easy. Remember, in chapter 4, we had one example where we had the numbers list again, of course, and we asked the question, is the square of at least one of the numbers in it above 100? Or I can reformulate this question. I can ask the question, is the square of all numbers in the list below 100? And how can I formulate this in a nicer way without the for loop? So in chapter 4, we did that with a for loop. Here, what we do is we use the all built-in. So all is a reducer, a reduction function, just like sum. And what we do here is we pass in a generator expression that loops over the numbers. And for every x, for every number in the list, takes the square and compares it to 100. So this expression here is a Boolean expression. It returns a true or false. And then the all function, the all built-in function, evaluates to true if and only if all of the elements it iterates over evaluate to true. Who would have thought? So the answer here is false. Why is it false? Because the 11, for example, the 11 squared would be above 100, would be 121. And then remember, we in chapter 3, we talked about short circuiting. So this is also implemented here behind the scenes. So the all function is smart enough to stop going over the numbers after it hits the 11. Because the 11 gives me back a false, and then the all function says, well, once I have encountered one false, it doesn't matter what the rest is, I just stop and return false. So the all function is quite efficient here. And similarly, we have a function called any, and I can ask the question, are there any x's in number, is there any number in numbers whose square is larger than 100? And the answer would, of course, be true. And if I play a little bit with the threshold here, let's say 1,000, I get back false. And any also implements short circuiting behind the scenes. Okay, so Boolean reducers, that was an easy topic. And now comes the last section of part 2 and chapter 7. And this is basically just repetition of everything we learned so far. But of course, as always, we want to give abstract, nice abstract technical terms to our concepts. So we have seen what are rules in memory. We have seen three types of rules. So here in our in the current diagram, we have a generator. And a generator is a rule that knows how to calculate stuff. We have seen two other types that do the same thing, of course, with a different rule, but they have the same logic. It's the map object and also the filter object. Now the question is, what do all these objects that model rules in memory have in common? Well, they have in common that all they know is they only know how to calculate the next object in line. They have no understanding, for example, of how many objects there are. You know, a list, I told you, a sequence, has the concept of length. We call this concept sized, that's the technical term, and a sequence can be asked with the built-in length function how many elements are in the sequence. But the rules that we have here, they are not that smart. The rules that we have seen in this chapter, they are super dumb. The only thing they can do is we can ask them with the next function, give me the next object in line, and they just give us the next object. And once they are out of items, they give us a stop iteration error, and that's it. And all data types in Python that behave like this, see that behavior is again the important thing and not the type. All the data types that behave like this, that behave like rules in memory, we call them iterators. Right? Iterators. And don't confuse that with another technical term called iterables. An iterable is anything that we can loop over. So a sequence would be an iterable, but an iterator is anything that only knows how to give us the next thing. So it's something, it's similar, but it's something totally different, actually. So let's look at an example, our numbers list again. And how do we get iterators? We use the built-in iter function. And what we do here is, I use the built-in iter function, and I pass in the numbers list, and I get back an object, and the object I get back, I store with the variable iterator 1. So let's do that. Maybe one last time, we draw a memory diagram. So what does that look like in memory? Well, of course, as always, we have a list that contains all the data. So list. And then we have the int objects, and so on. The list has a name, numbers. And now I pass numbers to the iter built-in function, and I get back an object. And we also do that a second time for illustration purposes. I get back iterator 2 now by calling iter again. And now the question is, what is the iterator? What is iterator 1? It's of type list iterator. So what we did here is, let's call it it. And we can also call it here iterator. And this would be iterator 1. And then we have a second object. I also write in it. And it's also of type iterator, list iterator to be precise, but I just abbreviated it with iterator. And this goes by the name iterator 2. We do that. Now the question is, what are the iterators? Well, I can already tell you that they are rules in memory that are somehow connected to the list that they are built with. So somehow both iterators are connected to the numbers list. So now what can we do with an iterator? I told you that they can only do one thing. We can only call the built-in next function with them. So here, in the next code cell, creates a tuple which consists of three elements that are drawn from iterator 1. And iterator 1, as I said, is smart enough to only give me the next object in line. So what will I get back here? Well, I get back the numbers 7, 11, and 8. Okay, that's it. So in other words, this is kind of like a lazy for loop. It's a rule. It's a rule in memory that knows how to calculate the next thing. And the thing is here, it doesn't have to calculate anything. It just has to loop. So it's like a lazy for loop. And now we can do another code cell here, and I say next for iterator 1 and next for iterator 2. And now I get back what? I get back the 5, which is the fourth element. And I get back the 7 again, which is here the first element again. So what does that mean? That means I now have two rules that are for loops that loop over the same object simultaneously, and they don't get confused. So in other words, I'm actually looping over numbers in parallel at the moment. And this works in Python. And why does it work? Because the for loop is not concerned with this object, with the list object here at all. The for loop only talks to those iterators, as we will see. And the iterators, all that they do is, they are really dumb. The only thing that they know is they know the last object that they gave you back. In other words, all they store in the boxes here, all the iterators store, is the index of the last element returned. Not even the object, just the index of the object that they just produced. And now we can ask the iterators, and we get back the objects on a one-by-one basis. Okay, and now I will show you another type of iterator of type SIP. There is a function built in Python. Let's maybe quickly see if we find it. So if we scroll down here, it's SIP. And now we also understand the documentation here maybe a little bit better after studying chapter 7. So the SIP built in, what does it take? It takes star iterables. So what does star iterables mean? Well, star here is the so-called packing operator, which means I can pass as many objects as an argument to SIP as I want. And by the name, by the argument name, which is iterables, I can already tell what the SIP function wants me to pass in. It wants me to pass in iterables. And then let's read documentation. What does it do? It says, make an iterator that aggregates elements from each of the iterables. Okay, let's see what that means. Well, by the name SIP, we can already tell that the behavior will be like a SIPper that you know from your jacket. So we SIP together two things, just like we SIP together a jacket. So let's create a SIPper object. So here, SIPper is an object of type SIP. So what did we do in the memory diagram? All I did, I created a new object, which is of type SIP. And yeah, it's just SIPping stuff, right? And we called it SIPper. That's the reference. And now what does a SIP do? Well, SIP is connected to this one and this rule. And the first rule, we call that source one. And the second iterator here, we call that source two. So whenever we go ahead and we ask SIPper now, hey SIPper, give me your next object in line, what SIPper does is, it talks to the first object, its first source, and says, hey, can you give me your next object in line? And then the iterator goes to the list and says, well, or basically the iterator remembers the last index that it got, and then it gets the next index and gives it back to SIP. And the same goes for source two. At the same time, SIP asks the SIP iterator two, hey, can you give me your next object? And then the iterator two object says, well, yes, I can. It remembers its last index. So it goes back to the list and obtains the element in the next index and gives back the element. And then all the SIPper does, it takes both elements that it gets from the two iterators, sticks them together in one tuple, and gives it back. So let's see that. So what can I do? Well, for example, instead of just, we do it manually. So we can, of course, call next with SIPper, and I get back 3 and 11. So why 3 and 11? Let's see. So 3 is the fifth number, and 11 is the second number. So it's the next number that is in line with the two for loops that are going on simultaneously right now. That's what SIPper does. And of course, we could also loop over it. So what we now get is, we get the remaining objects. However, note that we stop when the first source, when the first iterator here is exhausted at the 4, at which the second iterator is at 9. So in other words, the second iterator is not yet exhausted, it's just here. So we looped over numbers twice in parallel, and there was an offset between the two loops. And once the first for loop was done, the second loop had to be done, because the zipper function works like that. The zipper function will always only go on as long as it gets one object from all the sources, right? In the moment one of the sources to zipper are exhausted, then the zipper itself is exhausted. Okay, and now what do we see here? Well, what we see here is that I can actually loop over zipper. But now, wait a minute. Zipper, I told you, is an iterator. Why? Because it knows how to give me the next object in line. What we see here is that I can also loop over zipper. That means zipper must also be iterable. So it's both iterator and iterable. And this is true in general. Every iterator is always an iterable. And you can read in the chapter why this has to be the case. I don't want to go into detail here. But what we learn from this is that iterable means we have an object that we can loop over. And how does the looping work in Python? Now we finally understand how looping works in Python. Looping works in a way where Python creates iterators that only remember the last index, and then via the iterator, the loop is basically driven. So in other words, an iterable is any object that can create an iterator. And how do we create an iterator out of an iterable? Well, by calling the iterBuildIn function. So that's another abstract concept, but it's actually not that hard. An iterator, in layman's terms, is just a rule in memory that knows how to compute things without computing them. And then what we can do, now iterator 1 is exhausted, right? After the for loop that we just executed, iterator 1 is exhausted. So what does that mean? Well, that means if I call next with iterator 1, it will raise a stop iteration exception. It's exhausted. And now, what happens if I call next with iterator 2? Well, iterator 2 obviously was not yet exhausted, so it will give me back some more elements. For example, the 10, for example, the 1, for example, the 4. And then what happens? Finally, iterator 2 is also exhausted. So now we have stop iterations on both iterators. And now just to repeat this, it does not matter how often I execute this code again. In both cases, I will get nothing but stop iteration exceptions, because the iterators are exhausted. And as I told you, they are dumb. Once they are exhausted, they don't know how to go back. So they are really dumb objects. All they know is they know where they were. The only thing they remember is the last index that they returned. And when we ask next on them, then they will just give us back the next index. And once the object here is out of indexes, so we reach the end, then the iterator does not know how to go back. And then we can basically remove the iterator, because it's useless for us. And now that we have seen how iteration works in Python, let's quickly look at the for statement again. I told you in chapter 4 that the for statement is really syntactic sugar for the while statement. And if you want to know how I express that, you should look that up in chapter 4. However, in chapter 4, I was actually not telling the entire truth to you. So let's look again at what the for loop actually is. So an example, we create now an iterable. It's a list of numbers from 0 to 4. And now I use, as the variable names, the technical term. So I name it iterable. And now, in order to loop, we said anything in Python is an iterable that we can loop over. So what do we do? Well, we just write a for statement, for element in iterable. And then just to illustrate a point, we print all the elements on one line. And now I want to show you quickly what is the for statement really? So what does it really do? The for statement is really syntactic sugar for this here. That's what Python does when we use the for loop. So Python will first look at the iterable that we want to loop over with the for loop and ask, hey, you iterable, can you give me an iterator that knows how to loop over you, that knows how to get the next object in line, the next element? That's what the first line does. And then what happens here, we go into an indefinite loop, while true, and then we have a try except else. And in try, what we do is we try to obtain the next element from the iterator with the next function. And we know, we have seen that once the iterator is exhausted, it will raise a stop iteration error. So what do? Well, we accept for the stop iteration error, and whenever that occurs, we know that from then on it will always occur. So in this situation, we just break out of the while loop. And if we don't have a stop iteration exception, that means we are not at the end of the loop. That means we just execute the for loop's body, right? So in the else clause, we will see the for loop's body. And then to be super precise, what I forgot here, Python is actually kind enough to delete or to remove the reference, the variable called iterator again at the end. So this is what Python does whenever we execute the for loop. So let's do that, and we get the same output, of course. So this is how looping works. And once we have covered chapter 10 on object orientation, and we know some basics about object orientations, we can, in advanced with some advanced syntax in Python, create our own objects, our own data types that we can iterate over or use as an iterator. Okay, and now this is really the last section in this chapter. This is just to use everything we've learned and categorize the built-in sorted and reversed. So what are sorted and reversed? We have seen them before. So let's start with our numbers example again. And numbers is now a list. And the sorted built-in takes, as we saw in the documentation, any iterable and returns a new list with the elements of the iterable sorted. So I get back a new list sorted. However, the numbers list again remains unchanged. So sorted only iterates over the elements and sorts them, but it does not touch the numbers list. So in other words, sorted will always materialize a new list. On the contrary, the reversed built-in, if I call reversed and give it numbers, I get back a list reverse iterator. And now we know what that is. It's just an object, a rule in memory, that knows how to loop over the list, in this case, in backwards fashion, in reverse order. However, we only get back one object. So we don't get back a materialized list here. We only get back an object that we can use to loop over. And if we want to materialize this, we have to wrap it with the list constructor. And then, of course, I get the list reversed. And just remember, it's obvious, I guess, but sorting in reverse order and reversing are two different things. So I just want to show you how the built-ins, they return, you know, what the built-ins return may be different. So the sorted built-in returns a new list, and the reversed built-in returns an iterator. However, because iterators are always iterable, we can, of course, loop over the reversed object, which is why, and we have seen this before, we can write for number in reversed numbers and print out the numbers in reverse in one line. Okay. And numbers, of course, is also unchanged here, because again, numbers, the list type is a mutable data type. So in order to change numbers in place, we would use the list functions that are covered extensively in part one of chapter 7. And here we don't change the list in place. Okay, so this is it. This was the second part of chapter 7. I think this may be the first part in the course that may not be so super trivial, because we do all kinds of fancy things. But at the end of the day, what you learned in today's lecture was that how can we work with big amounts of data without having all the data in memory? That's the big storyline. And this prepares you for, you know, working with big data sets, of course, and running analysis in an efficient way. And now you have learned lots of information on what sequential data is. In chapter 9, when we talk about arrays and data frames, these kind of data structures, they are also kind of like sequential data, but they are not purely sequential data, which is why they are in a separate chapter. And also chapter 7, with almost, I think, 5.5 hours of lecture time, is also not just, it's already too much. I don't want to put more in this chapter. So that's what you've learned. And we have learned some more abstract behavior, so the behavior being an iterator. So the behavior of just knowing how to loop without looping. And we've seen several different data types in Python that make this work. So we've seen, for example, a generator expression that evaluates to a generator object, which is a rule. We have seen, for example, the reversed, which returns a generator or an iterator. So iterator is just the more abstract term, but a generator is basically an example of an iterator. And then we have seen the map object, the filter object, and so on. And then also we have seen the entire map filter reduce paradigm in this part here. And we have seen other nice things like the list comprehension. We have seen how list comprehensions always create lists that are materialized. And if we want to work in a memory efficient way, that's not what we want. And we also have seen some situations where we have to be careful, where some objects are materialized in memory without us knowing or seeing it. So we have to know the syntax in detail. And other than that, I think I leave you with that. This is enough material. And see you then in chapter 8.